We can start with the introduction. So as you've seen in the agenda, the focus for the Digit 2.6 release highlights is to focus on what are the new releases that we have had at a product level, and also what is our roadmap for a few missions, specifically the FSM or the fecal sludge management roadmap. And also we've been seeing a lot of the times our partners tend to have difficulty in accessing information. So we also thought it would be a good chance to introduce about the Digit Gitbook, which kind of will help you find answers and resources which can help you better understand Digit. So on that note, I think we can start. And yes, Chandrakiran, over to you for the first demo, which is on MGram Seva CK. Yeah.
Hey, thanks, Abhishek.
And one thing, participants, please send your questions on the Q&A box and we're more than happy to answer them for you. Yes, CK, over to you now.
Okay. Thanks, Abhishek. Hi, all. Good evening. Hope you're all doing well. Let me share my screen. Please confirm it is visible.
Yes, we can see your screen. Somebody from the participants can confirm as well. Will be helpful. Oh, yes.
Yeah. Super. So a little background on why MGram Seva, what MGram Seva does, right? This way, a couple of years back when Eager was trying to do something in the PFM space, we all are very aware that the PFM, the public finance space, has a lot of problems. And one of it majorly is the lack of fund visibility, the fiscal visibility in the government. So that is a space where we wanted to do something. And while we were talking to do different departments, like the Department of Water Supply and Sanitation, or the Food Department, and etc. in Punjab, we got a use case. Water Department in Punjab saying that they don't have a great visibility on some of the schemes. Schemes are nothing but like the projects, which are the, you know, tube wells or the bore wells, etc., that are built on the ground. So there are about 10,000 schemes, half of which are still continued by the department and half of handed over to the committees, which are formed independently. And these committees, once the schemes are handed over, there is no much visibility on how the scheme is functioning. For example, there is certain capital expenditure that the department puts and the scheme is functional. And after that, the maintenance of the scheme doesn't happen like how it has to be, because it is completely autonomous and the department doesn't have great visibility. Now, what the department, and because of that, the revenues and collections are not happening on time, and the expenditure, majorly like the electricity bill, are piling up for each scheme. After a few months or after a couple of years, the committees went back to the department asking for funds to pay off these electricity bills. And at one point, it was almost 1,100 to 1,200 odd crores that all these schemes together have piled up at the electricity department. Now, had this information been tackled earlier, had this visibility been given to either the finance department or the water department or even PSPCL that they are not able to pay off these electricity bills on time, there would have been better planning and better maintenance, sustenance of the schemes. So that is what MGram Seva is trying to do, getting the financial visibility of how these schemes are functioning on ground much earlier than what it has happened previously, right? So if you see on my screen, there's a citizen, and there are two entities right now, the Department of Water Supply and Sanitation and the Gram Panchayat Water Supply Schemes. And while the department continuing schemes are having full visibility and they're able to pay the bills, the ones that are handed over are having a lack of visibility, and these bills keep accumulating. And because of bills keep accumulating and they're not able to pay the electricity bills, and the electricity gets discontinued sometimes. So which results to the poor water quality, which results to unreliable water time and all these issues. So we wanted to tackle this problem using MGram Seva. Next slide. Yeah. So MGram Seva on a broad level has few personas and few systems in place. So actually, let me not go deeper into this one. I'll talk on a very broad level what exactly happens in Gram Seva. There is a committee, Gram Panchayat Water Supply and Sanitation Committee, which has multiple actors, your sarpanch, revenue collector, the treasurer, secretary, and so on. Now, these people have to ensure that the scheme has a proper sustenance, which is built by the revenue that they collect from in form of water charges. Now, every household in a Gram Panchayat, if the Gram Panchayat has 100 households, every household has to pay 100 rupees, which accounts to 10,000 rupees and monthly payment. Out of this 10,000 rupees, they might get an electricity bill of 7,500 rupees. The remaining 2,500 rupees has to go in form of any maintenance or salary for the revenue collector and all of these sorts. So now this revenue collection, which is nothing but the water bill from all the 100 households, and the expenditure, which is mostly the electricity bill and other many sort of maintenance, has to be logged into the application that we have built, which is called Gram Seva, right? Now, if I have talked about the personas, right? These are mostly the committee members at the Gram Panchayat. But how will the finance department get a visibility? Or how will the principal secretary of water department get visibility? So that is where the power of IFIX will come in, which is this. Now, from Gram Seva, all this data in the form of fiscal events will pass through a platform, which is called IFIX. Integrated Fiscal Information Exchange Platform. And from IFIX, the information will be again passed to a reference dashboard, to which all the various stakeholders at the state have access to and can view real-time information of all the funds that are getting collected at a Gram Panchayat level. So there are about 4,500 handover schemes and 5,000 department-owned schemes. All the 9,000 or 10,000 schemes information real-time will be shown on the reference dashboard with the help of IFIX platform. And also the PSPCL bills, which are upcoming, coming back to the Gram Seva, monthly electricity bills, will again be passed to IFIX platform and will be shown on the reference dashboard. So the state stakeholders will have a real-time visibility of what is my collection and what is my expenditure. Will I be able to meet my expenses with the collections that I am having, right? So this is the overall background of Gram Seva and IFIX and why we are doing it. I'll quickly now get into the demo of Gram Seva. Yep. So this is the home screen of Gram Seva. I have just logged into one of the user accounts. So you will see different functions that can happen on the Gram Seva application. Now, let me quickly show you how to create a consumer on Gram Seva. So these are the different fields that need to be entered. Now, who basically does it? It's the revenue collector who, while collecting the revenue, while going to each household, can do it. And it's a one-time activity. So we have recently launched the app, and while the app was getting launched, and this revenue collector had to enter it once. And all these fields, your name, address, and gender, door number, and if they have any previous arrears, until what month you have those arrears, and if your property is a residential property or a commercial property, and whether it's a meter connection or non-meter connection. Now, all this will get entered into the system, and even the arrears. Once the arrears and everything is entered, until we generate the first bill, this can be edited. So that is how we create consumers. And once the consumers are created, all the, let's say, 100 households in the GPWSC are added into the system. Now you have to go and generate bills. Now for every non-metered connection, we can just click on generate demand. And for which month you want to generate the demand for? For example, in this year, I want to generate demand for June. Usually the most recent month you want to generate demand for, which you have completed. And click on generate demand, it will generate a demand for all the households. Now every household after get demand generation will get a copy of their bill as an SMS onto the mobile. We will also see a notification on the home screen whether how much demand has been generated for this month. We will, so that's the demand generation for non-meter connections. And for the meter connections, a particular demand, the meter numbers have to be entered. And based on the rate masters, how much units have they consumed and how much is the price per each unit, the amount will be generated in, and the bill will be generated. So that's the difference between meter and non-meter. And also we have different slabs for residential and commercial connections. So this is mostly on the revenue side. Now coming to the expenditure side, if you want to create any expenditure entry, so you can click on add expense details, which is the type of expense you have, whether you have electricity bill, salary, or any other repair, chlorination, water treatment, all these things. And who is the vendor who's for whom you, this bill is being paid for, and what is the amount, what is the current bill bill date. Yeah, has this bill paid or is it a future bill, and you attach a bill and submit. So this will also create an expenditure entry in the application. Now that we have both revenue and expenditure for a particular period of time, be it a 1 month period or a longer time, we get this visibility upfront that how much is expectation or how much will be the deficit going forward. Right, and for the users at a Gram Panchayat, we can see the same on the Gram Panchayat dashboard, where on the screen currently I'm on the collections dashboard for February month. So I see overall there are 315 households, of which so many are residential and so many are commercial. And by each connection ID, I can see the name and the collections happened in this month. Now I can also, the ones that you see without an M are the non-metered and M are the metered ones. I'll quickly go to these, both of these. For example, this non-metered connection, the connection ID, consumer's name and the parents or spouse name, phone number, and all the details. And for this connection ID, a bill has been already generated previously, and also a receipt is there because the consumer has paid for it. Now I can also print and see the receipt. And download this. Yeah, this is available. The who is going on the Bluetooth, and if you want to share the receipt directly onto the how they received functionality was, if you open consumer which has a bill, a pending bill, which this current consumer doesn't have, or you can share the bill, or you can also try to print the bill. So the non-meter, the only difference between meter and non-meter, as we discussed earlier, is the rating and the rate master meter reading. So this is the collection dashboard. And on the expenditure dashboard, we also have what are all the bills that are created. If you see for January, there are two bills under different head of accounts. And let me open up bill and see. So this is one of the bill entered earlier. The type of expense, electricity bill, who is the vendor, and what is the amount, what is the bill date, this has been added. So this is all the collections, the expenditure, and the dashboards. Now, there is also a household register where at real time we can see how much is the pending amount, pending collection for the entire Gram Panchayat. Right? And this is not a month specific, this is overall from the time the system is added. So there's been a particular ask for this to get it printed and get it shared so the people know who are the defaulters and who has to be raised a penalty for. So this is a separate report that we would send out. And also all these dashboards and reports, whatever we see, can be shared on WhatsApp any point in time. Yeah, so these are majorly the functionalities of the application, the revenue, expenditure, and the dashboards. I mean, there are also notifications, there are 10 to 12 different kinds of notifications that these people receive based on the roles that they have assigned to. So a sarpanch receives how much is the entire collection in a particular day. How much is the expenditure in a particular day, a monthly summary. A revenue collector receives a reminder notifications that 10% of your GPWC is still not collected, so please go ahead and collect. And they also receive notifications like this amount is online collected online, this amount is collected offline this particular day. So all these have been added. And also this app is completely localized into three different languages. English is what you already see on the screen. We can also change the language to Hindi and Punjabi. the entire app gets translated into a different language. Yeah. So this is the functionalities of the application. Now, how does it really, how is it really performing on the ground, and how are people using it? Talking a little about that. So we have been talking about Gram Panchayats, right? Now this is all we have seen for a single Gram Panchayat. Now let's say there is a revenue collector who wants to do a collection for multiple Gram Panchayats. You can also switch to a different Gram Panchayat if you have been, if you're given access to, and do the same activities there depending on your role that is assigned, right? Yeah, that is a bit about it. Now, this is all in the Imran Seva, like I was mentioning, you know, code where the actual, you know, stakeholders like the principal secretary or the finance department or any other department want to see, they can see in a dashboard, which is like this, which is currently put on Metabase, which is a visualization, data visualization software. And there are different hierarchies in the department. Now, the last level which we are talking about is the Gram Panchayat, what are the plan sanitation committee. And these are all the Gram Panchayats that are already went live. And in these all Gram Panchayats, the total collected, like this is the dummy data right now, but if you see, the total collected amount till date, let me follow the filter. So I have filtered by one of the Gram Panchayats, which we usually respond. So yeah, so total collected amount is 53,000, and the total pending collection is 42,000. The total electricity pending payment, or the total bills that have yet to be paid are 4,000, and the total payment that is generated is 9,000. So on the expenditure side, I have a total cash flow of 13,000, and on the revenue side, I have a total cash flow of 95,000. So I know my I'm on a positive side, basically. I have a surplus, I'm more than deficit. So that's how we try to give this information upfront that to any stakeholder, that any GPWC slash scheme is either performing well or not. Right? And also this dashboard talks about multiple other data. For example, the same Gram Panchayat Lodhipur that we have filtered with, what is the demand, total demand, what is the pending collection, what is the receipt, and what is the bill. And also a performance graph on how are they performing, whether their this receipt is able to meet their demand that is generated. So anytime this blue line crosses the red line or touches the red line, we know that yes, all the water bills have been collected. Right now there is a gap of so much. And on the bill side, on the expenditure side, if you see, the cumulative bills have already touched the cumulative payments. You know, means all the bills have been paid for already. Whatever the 13,000 rupees was bills were raised, they were all paid. Right? And the pending collections. So Lodhipur has a pending collection of 40,000 rupees approximately. Right. Yeah. So this is the dashboard that we are presenting, but there are also a lot of announcements coming up, both on Imgram Seva and also on the Metabase dashboard. On Imgram Seva, things like a lot of integrations with external systems, and also new things on the dashboard, which will make collections easier happening. And on Imgram Seva also, we are trying to do some predictive analytics and see how we can help the stakeholders take better actions, not just providing revenue and expenditure summary, but also show what kind of actions should need to be taken at different risks that are associated with being surplus or deficit. So yeah, that's pretty much it. Did we receive any questions on the chat, Abhishek?
Not yet, Chandrakiran. But yeah, we can keep it open for a few minutes to see if the participants have any questions. So this implementation is currently live in Punjab, right?
Yes, Abhishek, that is right. We have gone live in about 90 Gram Panchayats. Mm-hmm. 60, we have started seeing data already. About 6.5 to 7 lakh collection has happened, and some expenditure bills also added, and it's going pretty well. Mm-hmm. So overall, if you talk about numbers and the scale, there are 12,000 consumers already registered on the application. There are 400 users who are using the application. The demand generated is about, again, 6 to 8 lakh rupees till date. Mm. So, yeah.
That's quite an adoption. I'm sure it is solving a lot of issues at the ground level.
Very much.
Transparency. We'll just give them a couple of minutes before we move on to the next presentation. So any questions, please send them over through chat, or if you want to speak, you can request for access, speaking access, and I can allow you to talk as well. Seems there are no questions from the attendees. Thanks a lot for that, Chandrakiran. It was a good presentation for us to understand how iFix was implemented, and most importantly, why did we do what we done? So that is interesting. So the next session in line for us is by Vaishnavi, where she'll be talking about the fecal sludge management roadmap. So Vaishnavi is from our product team again. So over to you, Vaishnavi. You can present your screen and.
Thank you. Thank you, Abhishek. I'm just sharing my screen. Please let me know if you can see it.
Yes. Yes.
Can you all see it? Okay.
See the screen. Let's ask the attendees if somebody can confirm if they're able to see the screen as well. We can move go ahead.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, they can see the screen. Perfect. You okay. Can go ahead.
Awesome. Thank you. So I'll just walk everyone through the fecal sludge management roadmap. Just to give a little bit of context, we are considering the non-network sewerage system here. So these are usually in the remote places and rural areas, which do not have proper sewerage lines. We are considering this in five stages, which is the containment, emptying, transport, treatment, and reuse and disposal. So usually under these houses, there are septic pits in which the fecal sludge is being connected. And the collected sludge over a period of time will be picked up and disposed at a treatment plant, which will later be treated and can be used for manure and stuff like that. And we consider this problem statement, and we wanted to solve issues in terms of sanitation here. With our version 1 product, version 1.1 and version 2, we are at the moment solving from emptying to treatment. From our understanding on the ground, we recognize four major users, which would be the citizens, the ULB, that is urban local body employees, the DSOs who would do the cleaning, and the fecal sludge treatment plant operators. So from the version 1 FSM web application, the citizen can create the application, which will then be received by the sanitary inspector or urban local body employee, who will review the information, see if it's all accurate, and then generate demand, for which the citizen will have to make a payment. And then once the payment is received, the urban local body employee will then assign a DSO who will check if he has vehicles available or if he can take on the request. He will assign the vehicle, and then he will complete the request by going to the citizen's location, picking up the sludge and dumping it at the plant operation. So here the FSTP operator will log in the vehicle details each time they come in and out. Once we released the V1 version, we were able to recognize some of the gaps on the ground. So the first version of FSM application provided access to citizens to request for service on the web app, and they had prepayment services. Through these applications, the ULB employees could, you know, track and manage how many requests are coming in from the citizens, and also assign DSOs. They had a better tracking mechanism and record keeping of the payment that they're collecting, and also have dashboards and reports to understand how much money is coming in, how many requests are getting created, and which of these ULBs are performing well or not performing. And at the DSO user interface, he or she would be able to accept the request and then go to the citizen location, complete the request and update the information on their application. And again, at the plant operator's level, the plant operator could enter each time the citizen is coming to the location and enter the in and out time and the capacity of the sludge that is being brought in. So just once this was launched, some of the major feedback and enhancement requests that we received were that most of these cleaning required more than one trip, and a lot of payments were happening after the service was provided or during the service was provided. So taking these use cases in, we enhanced the product. So at the moment, the citizen creates a request and the ULB employee, you know, assigns a DSO without taking any payment in. And once the DSO arrives at the location, they will decide how many trips it would require to clean the sludge, have a conversation with the citizen, and then generate the demand. So from the point the demand is generated till the point the DSO completes the cleaning, the citizen has the flexibility to make payment anytime from then on. So here we're able to accommodate multiple trips and also post payment for citizen. And the DSO will also have their self-reporting service via SMS. In addition to this is that because most of the payment was happening at the ULB level, now the DSO also could collect the payment in cash. The flexibility is still there for the citizen to make payment at ULB or through net banking. These were some of the enhancements that we did in version 1.1. Just beyond this, in version 2 and 3, we want to make this more accessible. We want to automate some of these things and also bring in monitoring system. So at the citizen level, we want to increase the access of this application through self-help groups and WhatsApp integration, and also provide grievance and complaint service. So they will have the opportunity to raise any complaint in case they were not satisfied with the service. And two other major enhancements we're considering is to have vehicle tracking and treatment quality monitoring. So through vehicle tracking, we want to make sure that the waste that is being picked up from the citizen's location is dumped correctly at the treatment plant and is not dumped in the open, causing more problems. So we're bringing in vehicle tracking for that. And with treatment quality monitoring, we want to have regular checks from lab results and also integration with IoT to make sure that the waste that is being treated is compliant with the standards. And in case it isn't, to make sure that a resolution can be found by the ULBs offline so that the standards are met and the treated waste can be further used for manure. Just beyond this too, we want to consider integrating this with the other eGov products that we have, which is the building permit, the property tax, and water sewerage. So just to give a brief overview of what we have in V1, V1.1, V1.2, these are some of the things we have in place. That's it from me. Any questions?
Good presentation, Vaishnavi. We'll just give the attendees a few minutes if they can think for questions. Meanwhile, I see that you've also mentioned about GPS-based tracking. So this is in line with the SBM mission as well, the Swachh Bharat mission, and their...
I think CK can speak more to that. CK?
Just want to understand if this is considered, because it's also mentioned as part of the minimum requirements across the state bodies as well.
Yeah, that is right, Abhishek.
Okay, so nice to see this evolving into being a single platform for sanitation across India. Yeah,
true.
Super. Do I see any raised hands? No. Do we see any questions? No. So perfect then. I think since we don't have any further questions, we can move over to the next session, which is on property tax and the new enhancements that we've had specific for this module, which has also been the flag bearer for Digit, the property tax module as well. And this is this presentation will be managed by Nirbhay Singh, who's from the product team. Over to you, Nirbhay. So you can present your screen and
it's sure. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. So let me present my screen. Please let me know if it is visible. Yeah, hope my screen is visible to all of you. Okay, so good evening. Let's start. We are going to present here the features which we have released with Property Tax Release 2.6. And so before going into the demos and to look into the features, let me give a kind of background of property tax, means what exactly property tax and what are the features which are already available with the Digit property tax. So property tax basically the main source of revenue for the ULBs, and Digit property tax provides a digital interface to the citizens as well as the ULBs to citizen to get their properties assessed, and to ULBs to use the system to assess the properties, generate the demand bills, and collect the property tax, and for the citizen to pay the property tax. Okay, so if you see the functional scope, we have a kind of user registration and login module, which is common to all the product of the Digit platform. Then along with this, we have registration of property, which is nothing but to register a property into the municipal system. And then there is a modification of property, mutation of property, search and view the property details, assessment of the property tax, demand billing and the collection of the property tax. And there are dashboard and reports to for the administrator of the ULB as well as the state people to view the performance of the property collections and other KPIs. Okay, so if we move to next slide, we can see means the property tax system is basically accessible via we have Digit mobile app, so that provides the citizens basically an easy way to access the services of property tax. So what exactly they can do, we can see from the screen, is they can search and pay, they can look at the bills which are pending for the payments, and then they can clear those bills. They can create a property, they can view all the properties which belongs to a logged in user. They can see the applications which they have applied for a particular service, whether it is to create a property or to modify a property or transfer of ownership. And they can apply for transfer of ownership. And the same thing can be accessed from Digit Pay application. And we have this WhatsApp, which enables the citizens to make the payment property tax bills. So these are the services already we have gone through. We'll skip this slide. Then at the ULB end for the employees, once the application is created, there is a flow through which they can process that application. So once it is created, it goes to the employee, document repair, employee field inspector, which is basically responsible to make a visit to the field and submit his report. And then the final employee of the ULB for approval of that particular application. Okay, so these are the features, highlights, which are the part of Property Tax 2.6 release. Okay, so here we have update mobile number. Next, we will covering these features in mostly four use cases. So here we can see update mobile number. This is a basically alert on before collection of the property tax for the employee. So we'll go through it. So I have skipped the login as of now. Okay, so here we can see the search property screen. And from here we can search a property. So the property can be searched by a mobile number or by property ID. Once it is searched, it is displayed in the search result, and from there we can see the search result, and on click of property number, it will open the property detail. So here we can see that there is a dues, and the employee can collect the tax by clicking on pay button. Second thing we can see here that the mobile number present in the owner's record is a kind of pattern 999, which is not a valid number. So if you just select on pay, it shows a pop-up saying that the associated mobile number seems invalid. So please update the mobile number, and with the option to continue for the payment to update a mobile number. If he continues for the payment, he will allow to complete the payment and generate a receipt. Okay, so again, can come back once the receipt is generated. It's still that associated mobile number is invalid one. Okay, so here we can again search the same property. View the detail. This time we'll click on pay. Again, we will get a alert message. And this time we'll select to update mobile number. So on click of update mobile number, we'll get a update mobile number window. There we'll enter up the valid mobile number and upload the required document. As of now, these are non-mandatory, but these are configurable to make it mandatory. Okay, so if ULBs for implementations want to make it mandatory, they can make it mandatory. Once it is updated, page will get refreshed and the updated mobile number will be shown here. Okay, so this is while before collecting the property tax. Okay. Okay, so why is this feature needed? You know, before we start second use case, basically this feature is needed where data is migrated from the old system, maybe any existing system, got digitized from the manual records. So there, most of the time it has been seen that the number given there in the records is very old number, are not a valid number. So then once all the data is there in the digit system, then it is required that to get all the mobile number updated, correct mobile number updated, so that the notifications to the citizen on the demand and payment side can be sent easily. Okay, so now this is the update mobile number and update alternate mobile number from view of the property detail. It is almost same. If you see here, again, we are on the search property screen. So we'll search a property by entering the property ID, and we'll see the search result. From search result, we'll click on the update property ID, unique property ID. And there we can see owner's mobile number and alternate mobile number. So if we click on add it, it will allow me to, again, it will open update mobile number window. There we can enter the, our employee can enter the mobile number and then click on update. It will display a success message, update mobile number, and the page will get refreshed. And we can see here that the new mobile number got updated. Okay, so at the back end, we can see here the alternate mobile number, the flow is same. So meantime, I'll tell you at the back end, it will send a SMS to both the mobile numbers, mean the earlier mobile number and the new mobile number, stating that your mobile number is got updated. Okay, so this is from the employee side. Same way we have update mobile number from the citizen side. If you see use case 3, so in citizen here we have update alternate mobile number after the payment of tax. So this use case is basically where a alternate number is not present in the owner's record. Okay, so again I'm skipping the login process and I'm coming to the home page of the citizen. Okay, so you can see here at the home page we have pay property tax, my property, and my applications. Here, first of all, we'll have a look at the property detail and we'll identify a property where the alternate mobile number is not present with the owner's record. So here we can see under the owner's details section, the alternate mobile number is given there is NA. Okay. While the mobile number is there, but alternate mobile number is given. So what we'll do, we'll go back to the search and pay. And this is a kind of open search and pay. For this, login is not required. Okay. So here, what we'll do, we'll search a property for the payment. Because this is a public screen here, only minimal information is displayed. Entire property detail cannot be seen here. Okay, so we'll search a property by entering the property ID, or we can search a property by entering the by owner's mobile number as well. So it will list all the properties which belongs to this mobile owner's mobile number. We identified the property as the number 6101 at the last. We'll click on pay. And we'll try to pay some minimum amount of 100 rupees. Click on make payment. It will take me to the payment gateway page. We'll select a card number, initiate a click to pay to complete the payment process. It is taking a while to complete the payment process. So once the payment is successful, it will take the user to the success page with the option to download the receipt. Okay, and there under that successful message, update mobile number text is displayed with the option to update the mobile number, alternate mobile number. On click of this, it will open an update mobile number window. Same time, it will send a OTP to the owner's primary mobile number. Once the OTP is received, user will enter the OTP in the OTP section and then will continue. So it is taking a while to receive OTP. Once it is received, will continue to enter the alternate mobile number. So in this, we'll enter the alternate mobile number. And again, we'll click on send OTP. So this will ensure that whatever number has been entered is a valid number and number belongs to the owner of the property who is right now performing this activity. Okay, so we'll click on verify. And update mobile number action, and then it will get updated. We'll enter a OTP And then now the success message has been displayed. So the alternate mobile number got updated. We can see this from the My Properties, View Properties screen. Okay, so this is the third case which got demonstrated. Okay, so now the fourth one is to update the mobile number and alternate mobile number from My Property View screen. So it is very much same as we have for the employee already we have seen. Okay, the only thing is for citizen, it is OTP based and allow citizens to update the mobile number or alternate mobile number through a OTP verification. Okay, so here we complete the flow and Abhishek, if there is any question, we can.
Yes, I think Mr. Tej Banta Singh has raised his hand. I'd love to talk so we can hear his question. Yes, you can speak now, Mr. Tej Bin Sankar. Okay. Mr. Tej Banta Singh, you can ask your question. You've raised your hand. Okay, must have been. Okay, but there are not many questions now. This is the end of your session, Nirbhai?
Yeah, it's the end of my session.
Okay.
So I think we can move to this.
Okay. Sure. So we'll give the attendees a couple of minutes. Meanwhile, from our previous session on FSM, there's a question by Mr. Sunny Kapoor, reading it out for us. Hi, I understand that the sludge module would be similar to DTDC functionality of solid waste management application. Is it possible to integrate the existing GPS device installed across sewage vehicles with the proposed module? Anybody from the panel can answer this question.
Okay, I can take this. We are working on, so as a functionality within Digit, you can have these integrations, right? One is that. Two, in sanitation itself on the Disha platform on FSM, we're working towards a POC where we are looking at integrating two types of information that are coming from different types of sensors. One is for treatment monitoring and the other is for tracking vehicles. The timeline for this is hopefully by March, April is when we're looking at V2 coming out. So that's when, does that answer your question? Who was this? Sorry.
Sunny Kapoor.
Sunny Kapoor.
Yes.
All right. Great.
Super. Oh, and you've also answered his second question. What are the timelines for V2 and V3 as well? So March, April, V2?
Yeah.
And V3?
V3, I think it's going to be based a lot on the feedback that we get really on the scale up across Odisha. So we will be taking some feedback from there and then scaling it up, and we'll keep everyone posted on what's going in V3 as well, and the timelines for that.
Super. Yeah. Thanks for this, Jojo. Yes, we will keep you posted. So we'll wait for a couple of more minutes before we start the next session. Anybody raising hands? Any more questions? Okay. Sure. So introducing the next presenter, Anju Narayan. So she manages the documentation and knowledge resources for the partners. So she's going to be introducing Digit Gitbook, which I think will add a lot of value to all our partners in different roles to access information and where to find what and how is it all structured. So this will be an interesting session as well by Anju Narayan. So over to you, Anju, whenever you are ready.
Thanks, Abhishek.
So before she starts, Anju has a poll. So I'll flash your poll, Anju.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So we're trying to understand how many of you folks have already used docs.digit.org website. So Yeah, I can see the responses coming in. Percent of the people have participated. I think we'll give it another minute to see if anybody else wants to submit their answers as well. Okay, I'm ending the poll. 50% of the attendees have answered the question. So I'm ending the poll. So you can see the results. Can you see the results, Sanju?
No. Yes, I can now.
Yeah. Oh, that's a good mix.
So it's a mix of yes and no. Okay. Fine. So let's proceed with the session. Good evening, everyone. So I would like to... This is the last part of the webinar. We just intend to walk you through the DIGIT documentation sites that we have created. And the basic objective of having these docs is to create a self-help tool for the users. And to get all kinds of help related to the DIGIT platform, to the use of the modules, different exemplars that we have. So to begin with, we have all these talks hosted on the Gitbook tool, and we have multiple mission docs for the sanitation mission, the PFM mission, or the urban mission. So if you can see on the screen, the urban mission docs are hosted on docs.digit.org, which probably quite a lot of you must have gone through it. The PFM mission is on ifix.digit.org and the sanitation mission on disha.digit.org. So what are the basic things that these docs are covering? They provide you with the mission objectives. What is the mission all about? What are the key things or the key outcomes that we are seeking from the mission? These are the kinds of introductory and overview details that we are covering in this part. Then we have the architecture details, which talks about the platform architecture, the specifications. Specifications are nothing but it is, since all these are on the open source, we are kind of giving you the standards and the principles based on which the interoperability of these platforms are used, and it can be further integrated and enhanced for specific use cases. Then we have the wikis, the technical enablement details, which is basically right from this part of the configuring of the systems to the use and the customization of the systems. Then we have the user manuals, the video walkthroughs, and the training materials. So I'll just walk you through some of these sites. Most to begin with, this is the urban site that we have, docs.digit. And this is the landing page. From here, you will be able to access all information related to our urban mission, all the product details, various customization and configuration documentations are available here. So we have added recently a very new tool, which is the Access Digit feature, where you can, explore the platform, generate your own credentials and explore the platform on your own, use the various modules that we have, and see for yourself what are the features, how the screens are placed, and what are the key functionalities that we are providing for each of these modules. Besides that, we also have the release notes section, which is giving you the current release details. All the release. So One of the basic features of Gitbook is that you have all the legacy previous versions available. So if you want to refer to the previous older versions, like let's say, for example, 2.4, you just need to click over here and you are taken to that particular release related documents. So besides this, we have the product mod. Product docs are posted over here in this section after the release documents. So the product docs will provide a comprehensive, it is segmented as per the modules. So when if you want any information related to trade license, you just need to click on it. You have all the details over here, including the master data template configuration details, implementation guides, functional details, as well as the user manuals and the UI details. So this the same structure has been followed for all the modules over here. So besides this, we also have the training videos, which are very useful in the sense it gives you a complete, you know, a video walkthrough of all the configurations and the workflow videos. So these things, these are just small videos which will walk you through the entire application, the screens, and the features and various functionalities. Besides this, we also have the technical enablement documents. So we have the list of all the technical enabled documents over here as per this table. If you go, you will find everything related to your localization or role mapping, master data setup details, everything is given out here, listed out here. So just click on these links and it will take you to the respective pages. Now, this is one more section which is very important, which gives you a complete details about the Digit platform setup, a quick start guide sort of, and including the installation details as to how to set up, install the Digit platform on various platforms and various environments, as well as we have the productionized Digit. So these documents are also very useful for the setup purpose, and followed by the configuration and the customization documents. So any kind of urban mission related documentation is available on this particular site. Besides this, okay, next I'll walk you through the sanitation mission site, which is the ifix.digit.org. So currently we have all the ifix related documents over here. So if you go to the platform section, you will find all the platform related details, including the link to the source code, as well as the installation details. And then we followed by the exemplar, which will be covering the MGram Seva, iFix adapter, and the dashboard documents. So we have all the technical as well as user related documents hosted on these in these sections. Besides this, we also have the link to the roadmap as well as discussions. The same structure has been followed for the DISHA, that is the sanitation website too. So we have all the mission related documents in one place, the sanitation platform documents, the architecture, policy, governance, as well as the specifications. And the exemplar, which is the FSM related documents. We'll be expanding this site more in the coming months. So I think there'll be a lot to look forward in this section also. And at the end, I would like to just give you a deep overview of the specification sites that we are building. It is currently work in progress, but yeah, it is, we already have the specifications in place for the platform, the Digit platform as such, the taxonomy, the data modeling, as well as the API details are will be provided over here in this particular site. So we have also the exemplar details added on, as for the property tax, PGR, the trade license, and these are the currently hosted exemplars which we have populated. And we plan to make it more comprehensive and consolidated for the rest of the products as well. So that brings an end to my session. Any questions?